book of Luke, chapter number 22. We'll do some more singing here throughout the service this evening. But as we said just a moment ago, the service tonight, although every service when we come to the house of God should be centered around Christ and around His death, burial, and resurrection, tonight is a special night because we do want to observe the Lord's Supper and ultimately focus everything back on the Lord's sacrificial death, His vicarious death, which means His death on our behalf. And so tonight we're going to do exactly that throughout the service. Luke chapter number 22 is where we're going to start. Shortly after, before being betrayed in the Garden of Gethsemane on the Mount of Olives by one who walked with Him daily, Jesus instructed His disciples to remember Him through a time that we refer to as the Lord's Supper. When we look back to the gospel accounts of this story, we gain a clear understanding of what transpired and what it is that we as Christians in the 21st century emulate when we talk about the Lord's Supper. So here in Luke chapter number 22, look at verse number 7 with me if you would to start off. Verse number 7 says, "Then came the day of unleavened bread, when the Passover must be killed." And the emphasis there is on the day of unleavened bread, and then that last phrase, "the Passover must be killed." The celebration known as the Passover was started in the Old Testament when the nation of Israel was in bondage. God, as we know, had sent a messenger by the name of Moses to tell the king of Egypt, Pharaoh, to free the Israelite people. Pharaoh would not let the people go, so God sent plagues upon the Egyptians. And we're familiar with that story and familiar with those plagues that He sent, 10 plagues in all. The last of these plagues was the death of the firstborn. To provide a way of escape for those who believed, God instructed the people to take a lamb that was unblemished and to kill it. They were then to take the blood of the lamb and smear it on the two side posts and the upper door posts of the house. And we've talked about this before in our studies and in our teaching and preaching of the Word of God, that as they took that blood and they smeared it on the side posts and over the door, that if we tonight could just picture that door where they put that blood, no doubt because the lives of their firstborn in that home were on the line, they would take that blood and they smeared it all the way up the side and maybe even past the top of the door just a bit on the right side and then again on the left side. And then as they brought it across the top, they more than likely went a little bit to the left and went all the way to the right and even maybe crossed over those two side post lines, ultimately to assure that they had not missed a spot, to make sure that there was not one spot on the upper door post or the side door post that was missed, because the firstborn in their household, that individual's life was on the line if they forgot any blood or missed any blood on the side post or the upper door post. And so we can picture that door in our minds tonight, and we can picture that blood. What we would be able to see is we'd be able to see two bloody crosses with a door in the middle, which of course is a picture to us of the cross of Calvary that Jesus died on. Remember, He said that He is the way, the truth, and the life. He is the door to heaven, He once said. And there He hung between two thieves, right in the middle. And so this was the instruction that was given to the Israelites in the Old Testament. When the angel of the Lord came to kill the firstborn, ultimately the angel would see the blood, and as we just sang a moment ago, would pass over the house. Inside the home that evening, believers would sit and eat the meat of the lamb along with unleavened bread. Bread that was made without any leaven, because remember that leaven was a picture of sin in the Old and in the New Testament. So unleavened bread and herbs as well. We actually sort of have a picture up here of a cup with juice in it, or in the Bible it's referred to as wine, but we know it's unfermented juice. It's not alcoholic juice. And then, of course, the unleavened bread behind. The Lord instructed the Israelites to continue this tradition annually in the form of a feast known as the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And so to start off our service, we're just recollecting tonight what it was that Jesus was doing here in Luke chapter number 22 and verse number 7. See, on the first night of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which was the 14th day of the first month of the Jewish calendar, the children of Israel would do as their forefathers had done. They would take a lamb that was without blemish, kill it, roast it, and eat it with unleavened bread. Just as the rites they eat centuries before. The celebration would continue until the 21st day of the month. All the while, the people would unleavened bread. Now look down, if you would, to verse number 14 with me. Verse number 14, the Bible says, "And when the hour was come, he sat down, and the 12 apostles with him. And he said unto them, With desire I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, Take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come." So here Jesus, being a Jew, being an Israelite himself, sat down with the 12 men who had accompanied him during his earthly ministry. These were the disciples, the 12 apostles. And he observed this traditional feast, the feast of the Passover with them, and particularly eating of that sacrificed lamb. As they sat around the table that had been prepared for them and ate, we find from the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that ultimately Jesus shared his heart with his disciples and pointed out the sad truth that there was a betrayer among them. Turn over to the book of John now, if you would. John chapter number 13. John chapter number 13 and verse number 2. John chapter number 13 and verse number 2. And we're going to read that first phrase, and I'm going to stop for a moment and try to illustrate something if I could, so we understand the context of what is going on here. It says in verse number 2, "And supper being ended." Now, when it says supper being ended, it does not mean that the disciples had stopped eating, but what it means is that Jesus had stopped eating. As it will be illustrated a little bit later here, and a few of the verses that we're going to look at in just a minute, the disciples were still eating. In fact, Jesus was going to give a morsel of the unleavened bread to Judas as a sign that he was the betrayer. So the disciples had not stopped eating, but Jesus had. So when it says that supper being ended, it's referring to Jesus. Let me illustrate it this way. When you sit down at home and you have a meal, and some of you are faster eaters than others. I'm probably the fastest one in my house. And so we sit down and we eat and we fellowship. But as soon as I'm done, I usually get up from the table and I take my plate to the sink. Now, everybody else isn't finished, but my supper has ended. And that's ultimately what's being explained here. What we'll see in just a few moments is Jesus had ended his eating. He was done with his Passover feast, but the disciples were still eating. And that's important because we're going to see some things about the supper here in the verses that we look at to follow. But back to chapter number 13, look at verse number 2 again. It says, "And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands and that he was come from God, and went to God, he riseth from supper, and laid aside his garments, and took a towel, and girded himself." So Jesus had finished eating supper, the disciples are still eating, he gets up, he gets a towel, and he goes around and he begins to wash the disciples' feet. And he ultimately shares with them that challenge in verse number 15, about the fact that he had given them an example, that he wanted them to serve the same way that he just served them. But then, as we said a moment ago, he goes on to explain to them with a heavy heart that there was a betrayer among them. Look at verse number 21. The Bible says, "When Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit, and testified and said, Verily, verily, I say unto you that one of you shall betray me." The disciples, in this account, as well as in other gospel accounts, begin to ask, themselves, well, who is it? Or they begin to question among themselves, who is it? Simon Peter asked John, who was sitting next to Jesus, to ask Jesus who it was, in verse number 25. He then, lying on Jesus' breast, saith unto him, Lord, who is it? So here they were. Jesus had sat that down, and John is sitting the closest to him, and is sitting really in a tight quarters with Jesus. Peter must have been on the other side of John for Peter to ask John to ask Jesus this question. Hey, ask Jesus who it is. And so John turns to Jesus and said, Lord, who is it? Verse 26. Jesus answered, He it is to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped it. That means he took a portion of that unleavened bread and he dipped it in a sauce of some sort, and then maybe a sauce of herbs, and then he handed it, it says, verse 26, and when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. Now, not everybody heard this conversation between Jesus and John. What if John really understood what Jesus said or heard him, we don't know for sure. But the Bible goes on to say in verse 27, and after the sop, Satan entered into him, talking about Judas. Then said Jesus unto him, That thou doest, do quickly. Now no man at the table knew for what intent he spake this unto him. For some of them thought, because Judas had the bag, that Jesus had said unto him, Buy those things that we have need of against the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. He then, having received the sop, went immediately out, and it was night. So Jesus took that unleavened bread, he dipped it, and he gave it to Judas, and this was a sign that Judas was going to betray him. But following that, he said to him in verse 27, That thou doest, do quickly, talking about the betrayal. And the rest of the 11 that were sitting there didn't understand why Jesus had given him the sop, or why he had said to him what he had said, but ultimately because Judas was the one who was in charge of the money, or the responsibility of carrying the bag that they put their money in as a group, they figured that Jesus was sending him on a mission to go get more supplies for the feast, or maybe to go make a donation to the poor. Nonetheless, they continued to eat. Now, as we study the Gospels, we find after Judas Iscariot exited the upper room that Jesus then took elements sitting at the table and gave the other 11 instructions concerning how they could remember him after he was gone. Turn back to Matthew chapter number 26. This is important. Though it's a small detail, it's very important. Because Judas, as one preacher said, is the disciple who kissed the door to heaven but went straight to hell. Judas was the one who was unconverted. He was unsaved. And Jesus, being the Son of God, knew the hearts of every one of those disciples. And so he waited until after Judas had left or exited before he went ahead and gave this instruction about the Lord's Supper or how to remember him after he was gone. It's important tonight that if you're sitting here and you don't know Jesus Christ as Savior, that you understand that this is a memorial for those who are believers. That Christ died for you. He died for your sins. Just like he died for mine and he died for the rest of the sins of all mankind. But tonight, you need to trust Christ as your Savior. You don't want to partake of this. You should not partake of this if you are not a born-again believer. If you have never trusted Christ as your Savior. Because this means nothing to you tonight. It would be similar to, because we use the ring when we're talking about baptism. The ring is a picture showing that showing outwardly to everyone else what happened the day that I got married. That I was joined in holy matrimony. I wear that ring so that way people know I'm married. And baptism shows people what happened in my heart. When a person gets baptized, it evidences to everybody else or illustrates to them, hey, this person trusted Christ as Savior. Well, when you take the Lord's Supper, ultimately, it's like wearing a wedding ring but not being married. What's the point? There is no point. You don't understand the significance of that ring. And so tonight, we see that Jesus made sure that Judas exited the scene before he then turns to the disciples and explains to them how to remember him. In Matthew chapter number 26 and verse number 21, verse number 21, the Bible says here, "And as they did eat, he said, Verily I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And they were exceeding sorrowful, and every one of them shall say unto him, Die." Now, we just read that passage back in John just a moment ago. And remember, I told you, it said that supper being ended, but it was talking about Jesus had finished eating. But the disciples continued to eat, and it says that here in verse number 21. They did eat. Jesus tells them, someone's going to betray you. And they began to question. And he answered and said, He that dippeth his hand with me in the dish, the same shall betray me. The Son of Man goeth as it is written of him. But woe unto that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It had been good for that man if he had not been born. Verse 25. Then Judas, which betrayed him, answered and said, Master, is it I? He said unto him, Thou hast said. No doubt when he gave him the sop, the question was asked, Master, is it I? And Jesus handed him the sop, the token that he told John, it would be the token of the betrayer. And he handed it and said to him, No doubt, Thou hast said. And immediately, the Bible said back in the book of John that Satan entered into Judas's heart. He got upset about it. Jesus told him, What you're going to do, go do quickly. And he left. And then look at verse number 26, if you would. And as they were eating, so the disciples are continuing to eat, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, Take, eat, this is my body. And he took the cup and gave thanks and gave it to them, saying, Drink ye all of it. For this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins. Luke tells us in his gospel that this instruction was given after the 11 had finished eating. Turn over there real quickly now. Luke chapter number 22. Luke chapter number 22 and verse number 19. Once again, all of this is part of just recollecting where the Lord's Supper started, where it had its foundations and how it came about. Luke chapter number 22, and look at verse number 19. The Bible says here in verse number 19, And he took bread and gave thanks and brake it and gave unto them, saying, This is my body which is given you, for this do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. So, real quickly, just reviewing. Jesus is sitting there with his disciples, and they're eating the Passover supper. Jesus finishes, he gets up, he takes a towel, he goes around and washes everybody's feet. He says, I want you, because I'm a servant, and I'm your Lord, I want you to follow my example and be a servant. He then tells them, someone's going to betray me. Someone in this room is going to betray me. And they all begin to question and ask. And Peter says to John, John, ask him who it is. And so John says, Lord, who is it? And so Jesus says to him, the person that I give the sop to, that is the one. That's the betrayer. And so he takes that piece of unleavened bread, and he turns and he dips it in that sauce of some sort, and he goes to hand it to Judas, and Judas says, Lord, is it I? And he says, Thou hast said, and he gives it to him, and Judas takes it, and he eats it, and he walks out of the room upset because Jesus has told him to go do what he's supposed to do and to do it quickly, talking about betraying him. He leaves the room, and the rest of the disciples keep eating, not realizing what's going on. Jesus then takes some of the unleavened bread, and he takes the cup with the unfermented juice, with the grape juice, and he goes ahead and he prays over that bread, and he breaks it, and he distributes it to them, and he takes the cup, and he prays over it, and he passes it around, and this is all done after supper. And the reason why it's important in verse number 19, verse number 20, that you notice that it's after the supper, is because they have finished the Passover supper. And now he's going to instruct them about the Lord's supper. You see, the Passover supper was a time of remembrance. But it was a time when they filled their bellies as well. They feasted. And as they feasted, they remembered what God had done for their forefathers in Egypt. The Lord's supper was also a time of remembrance, but it wasn't a time in which a person was to get full, but a person was already full. They had been filled with the love that God gave. They had been filled with the comfort that came from the Holy Spirit of God. And so ultimately they were already full, but these two elements, the bread and the juice, were used to illustrate two important things that we'll talk about here in a bit. Nonetheless, he tells them to go ahead and take the unleavened bread and to eat it, to take the cup and to drink some of that juice. And that is how they observe the Lord's Supper. And that is how the church has observed the Lord's Supper down through the centuries. Let's go ahead and take our songbooks again. Now let's turn to page number 5, if you would. Page number 5, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Page number 5, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. We'll do 3 verses tonight. The first, the second, and the last. First, second, and last. Page number 5. Chapter number 11. When we fast forward now to Paul's first letter to the Corinthian believers, we see that the churches of the first century continued to remember the Lord's death through the observance of the Lord's Supper. Paul acknowledges this here in 1 Corinthians 11, verse number 23. Notice what he says there. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. Let me read that once again for emphasis tonight. For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you. Paul had been instructed to remember the Lord's death through the Lord's Supper from the disciples who had taught him. And so this was passed on to him, and he passed this on to the believers at Corinth and to every church that he started and influenced. He would pass this along. Verse 23, he goes on to say that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." After the same manner, also he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye, as oft as ye drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, ye do show the Lord's death till he come. Now obviously it was something that they were going to observe on an annual basis, just as they had observed the Passover. And as we've seen in studies before and in times past when we observe the Lord's Supper, the Jews looked to the Passover and they observed the Passover because of what God had done for them specifically as a nation. But tonight, as Jews and Gentiles alike can come together under the banner of the cross, and we can observe the Lord's Supper together, because ultimately we look back to the cross of Calvary where Christ didn't just die for one nation or one people or one ethnicity, but died for all of mankind. And so they observed this there in the church in Corinth, and Paul had observed this, and the other churches of the New Testament time were observing this. Unfortunately, Paul mentions in the next few verses how that some of the believers of the church here at Corinth had been polluting this special time with ungodly actions or wicked living. Therefore, Paul challenged them to take time to reflect upon their lives. Look at verse 27. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together to eat, tarry one for another. It's important that every Christian examines himself or herself tonight and make sure that he or she does not have unconfessed sin that would keep them from remembering the Lord's death with a sincere heart. The church at Corinth had started off right, but somewhere along the line, they had looked at the Lord's Supper in the wrong way. They had looked at it in a monotonous way. They had looked at it in a ritualistic way to where, okay, we're taking the Lord's Supper, and they just took it without having their heart in it or having their heart right with God. And so Paul challenged them, not once, but twice in this passage. In verse 28, let a man examine himself. And then again in verse number 33, tarry one for another. In other words, you wait and make sure that you as a congregation are right with God. So that when you observe this, when you take the Lord's Supper, you're doing it individually as people who are right with God, but wholly as a congregation that is right with God. I would compare it to going to a grave site and someone going to that grave site having an issue in their heart. Maybe a seed of bitterness in their heart. You know, before those that are around that grave site can truly remember that individual and honor the life and the death of that individual, everybody's heart has to be right. If you've ever been to a funeral service where someone wasn't right, someone had anger or bitterness or something inside them, you know that it was sensed by others that were there as well. And so tonight it is important that we have a sincere heart. See, the Lord's Supper does not save a person. We understand that. Just like baptism, it doesn't save anyone. But it is an important thing, and it should not be done hastily, and it should not be done in vain. So we're going to sing one more song, and then we're going to go ahead and take a few minutes to let everyone examine themselves. Do a self-examination. Take a couple minutes. Just pray and make sure that your heart is right with God. Maybe there's something that you have as unconfessed sin, and God needs you to confess that tonight, and you need to confess that tonight, so that as we proceed in the Lord's Supper, that your heart will be a sincere one. Let's turn to page 10. Page number 10. And we'll sing Near the Cross. Once again, just three verses. three verses. Verse number 10, we'll do the first, second, and last, and after we sing the third verse, we'll let the music continue to play, and you go ahead and do business with God.
Jesus, we hear the cross.
Grateful heart. page number 10. Near the cross of the Lamb of God, we'll close with that verse. We're going to start our time of prayer.
Near the cross, O Lamb of God, fragrance deeply holy, every offering
the Lord's Supper this evening. I'm going to ask the ushers to come to get prepared, have them take a seat here on the front row as you turn over to Mark 14. And as we prepare for this, I would like to remind everyone that this was an ordinance that the Lord Jesus Christ gave to the first church, just like the ordinance of baptism. And it's been passed down to churches throughout the centuries. This means that those who are members of the church are to participate. And for the safety of the church and of this special time, I would ask all those that are not members of this church to refrain from taking the Lord's Supper with us tonight. When the plates are containing the bread and juice are passed, let me encourage you to refrain, but let me also encourage you that we will have another opportunity. And that's going to be on Sunday, April 24th in the evening. We're going to observe the Lord's Supper once again, as it was the tradition in the Old Testament. If someone was not able to take the Passover feast or observe the Passover feast in the Old Testament at the time set aside on the 14th of the first month, then they were allowed the following month. And so we're going to observe the Lord's Supper a second time next month, and I'd encourage you to do so at that time. Don't take offense to this instruction. It's nothing against you personally, but in the day and age in which we live, there's a real attack against the Word of God. There's a real attack against the Church of God. And so as the pastor of the church, it's my duty to make sure that I protect this body and that I protect this book that I hold in my hands this evening. And so please don't take it as any offense towards you. But look here in Mark chapter number 14, if you would, verse number 22. Verse number 22 says, "And as they did eat, Jesus took bread and blessed and broke it and gave to them and said, 'Take, eat, this is my body.'" Now, I'm going to go ahead and ask the ushers to come, and they're going to stand here and get ready to go down the aisles and hand the bread plates down the rows. But before they do, I'm going to pray and ask the blessing upon it. And then before we actually partake of it, I'm going to just read a few verses about the body and the suffering of Jesus Christ. So let's go, Lord, in prayer here real quickly before the ushers go down the rows here. Father, thank you for all that you've done for us. Thank you for all that you've given to us, Lord. I am so grateful that we can come together and remember what your Son Jesus Christ did for us. And Father, I pray that you'd help us to truly be a grateful people. I know that some of us in here have been saved for just a short time, others for years. And Lord, we never want to get used to the fact that we are born again and on our way to heaven. We never want it to become something that we're just used to and it's old hat to us. But Father, may we get a fresh anointing tonight. May our joy be restored to us if the devil has stolen it from us. Father, I pray, Lord, that you would just now bless this bread, this unleavened bread. Father, as we take it and we receive it, may we think about the body of your Son, Jesus Christ, that was offered up on that cross, that was beaten before it was taken and hung, and Father, ultimately was laid in that grave. Father, thank you for what he did. And we pray that you bless our time of remembrance now in Jesus' name. Amen. The ushers are going to come down and hand the bread out as the music plays. And you go ahead and keep a serious mind about you, if you would. We'll have an attitude of sobriety as you receive one of these. And you take that bread and you look at that. You remember the body of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Jesus had taken the bread and he blessed it and he began to break it. And as he did, ultimately what he was trying to illustrate to the disciples, to the 11 that were still there, is the battering that his body would take at the hands of sinful man. In Isaiah 53, verse number 5, Isaiah the prophet wrote, "But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities." In Matthew chapter number 26 and verses 65 through 68, we have the account of his bruising. It says, "Then the high priest rent his clothes, saying, He hath spoken blasphemy. What further need have we of witnesses? Behold now, ye have heard his blasphemy. What think ye?" They answered and said, "He is guilty of death." Then they spit in his face and buffeted him, and others smote him with the palms of their hands, saying, "Prophesy unto us, thou Christ. Who is he that smote thee?" In John chapter number 19, verses 2 through 3, we read more about the bruising that he endured. "And the soldiers plaited a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they put on him a purple robe and said, Hail, King of the Jews! And they smote him with their hands." Then in John 20, verse 25, we read about the affliction that he endured in his hands and in his feet. Doubting Thomas had said the other disciples had told him about Jesus resurrecting, and they said, "We have seen the Lord." But he said unto them, "Except I shall see in his hands the print of the nails, and put my finger into the print of the nails, and thrust my hand into his side, I will not believe." The story is told of a little boy and his father who were driving down a country road on a beautiful spring afternoon. Suddenly, out of nowhere, a bumblebee flew in the car window. Since the little boy was deathly allergic to bee stings, he became petrified. His father quickly reached out and grabbed the bee, squeezed it in his hand, and then released it. But as soon as he let it go, the young son became frantic once again as it buzzed by the little boy. The father sensed his son's terror. Once again, he reached out his hand, but this time he pointed to his hand. There, stuck in his skin, was the stinger of the bee. "You see this?" he asked. "You don't need to be afraid anymore. I've taken the sting for you." Jesus took the sting of death by sacrificing his body to the rioting mob. and allowing them to hang him on the cross of Calvary for our sins. Peter wrote in 1 Peter 2:24, who his own self bare our sins in his body on the tree, that we being dead to sin should live unto righteousness. As we take this unleavened bread tonight, may we remember the words of our Savior to his disciples in the upper room that fateful night. Take, eat, this is my body. I'm going to ask the ushers to come now and prepare to hand out the juice. And once again, as they get that ready, we'll go ahead and pray. And remember that the juice is symbolic of the Lord's blood. And so if you'll come, gentlemen, after they are ready, we'll pray and ask the Lord to bless this as well. There are two facets, as we said, to the Lord's Supper, the body and the blood. And that's what we want to recognize now. Father, thank you once again for your Son, Jesus Christ. And as we've already acknowledged, we're so thankful tonight for him taking our place and being bruised and beaten and hung on that cross. Now, Father, we think about his blood. Father, his precious, holy blood that was shed for our sins. Father God, we know that if he had not bled, we could not be saved tonight. And so, Father, we pray that you bless this time of remembrance as well. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen. The ushers will come and distribute those as the music plays once again. Verse number 23 of Mark 14, it says, and he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to to them, and they all drank of it. So Jesus, secondly, after taking the bread and blessing it and breaking it and distributing it, took that cup full of that juice, that unfermented wine, because of course it was a representation of his blood, and his blood was sinless, undefiled, pure. And he ultimately reminded them that his blood was necessary for atonement. For someone to be saved, the blood was necessary. In Hebrews 9:22 it says, "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood. Now without the shedding of blood is no remission." In Matthew 27, verses 26 through 29, we have the account of him shedding blood. It says, "Then released he Barabbas unto them, and when he had scourged Jesus," that means that they whipped him until he bled, "he delivered him to be crucified." Later on, in verse number 29, it says, "And when they had plaited a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head. Lunging that crown of thorns into his head caused him to bleed, not only from his back, but from his skull as well." In Isaiah 50, in verse number 6, Isaiah wrote, "I gave my back to the smiters and my cheeks to them that plucked off the hair. They ripped the beard from the face of our Savior, causing him to bleed from his face as well." And then, as he was there on the cross, in John 19:34, it says, "But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water." Back in Isaiah 53:5, Isaiah wrote, "The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes ye are healed." Tonight, because of the blood of Jesus Christ, we're healed. We're no longer condemned to death because of his blood. So may we once again think back to the Lord's instruction to the 11 concerning the juice in the cup. "Drink ye all of it." In conclusion, when we look back to verse number 26 of Mark 14, we read, "And when they had sung a hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives." So as it has been our tradition here at Victory Baptist, let's go ahead and stand and sing "Amazing Grace," page 487. You may know it by heart, and if you do, then please feel free to sing with us. I apologize, I think that is the wrong page number. Let me find the right one. That's the songbook that we use at Hanbury. Yeah, that's the old songbook. 244. "Amazing Grace." Let's go ahead and sing all four of those.
Oh,
God.
Praise God, 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 praise God.
Amen. Can't you just hear that in heaven one day?